It is Wednesday. We are Wizards. And today is a day that we like to call Wizard Wednesday. Channeling in with so much quantum style through the quantum downs, this is Elf.
And Dota.
And the bear.
We've got a big show today, guys. We're going to have a special guest in the second half of the show. But before we get to that, I just want to just give some updates, some announcements, go over some questions from the Secret Tower. So let's jump right in. The first thing is, so I think we're going to push the conversation about Rings of Power and House of Dragon to next week.
Good, because I haven't watched them yet.
I watched it yesterday just because you said we had to. So
I know. Some people didn't do their homework, and then the ones who did do the homework are upset that the ones who didn't are getting more time. I know.
I've never done my homework, so you can't expect me to do it on time.
But no, this will give more people time to watch and therefore formulate their opinions. But, you know, I just want to clear one thing right off the bat. I know that Rings of Power gets a lot of hate for various reasons. And obviously House of Dragons is a better show by all accounts. I get it. But I still think Rings of Power is at least a good case study in world building and also just franchise building. And honestly, I don't think the show's that bad. I don't think it's as bad as a lot of... What's that?
Yeah, I like it.
Yeah, no, there are like characters and there are scenes that I actually enjoyed. There's a lot that I didn't enjoy, but like, come on, it's not that bad.
No.
No, it's not bad. I would never label that show as bad, ever.
Yeah.
How could you spend $500 million and it be bad?
Yeah, it's possible. but no, I hear you. You know, and again, we can like get into it next week. But I mean, obviously, House of Dragons is way better. I feel like that show has potential to be as good as Game of Thrones. It's in my opinion. I think it's awesome. But yeah. So anyway,
are we doing this?
What's that?
I was gonna say, are we doing this?
Into the conversation now? No.
Yeah, I guess we're gonna push it. All right. Yeah.
Yeah, we're gonna push it. So yeah. Anyway, I just wanted to clear that up. A few other things. So Dota and I appeared on the famous YouTube crypto show called Altcoin Daily. We did that last week, and I believe the episode will be airing tomorrow. Is that correct?
That's what they told us, yeah.
Yes, that's correct.
Awesome. Yeah, I thought it was a good show. Aaron asked some really great questions. I think he totally understood what we were doing. So I'm looking forward to that. And then Dota, you actually did an interview with, tell us about the interview you did recently.
Yeah. So I also did an interview with Hard Fork Gaming. So, they are big fans of Wizards over here and they really, really know their stuff. You know, a lot of these interviews that we go into are maybe sort of like, you know, they interview a lot of NFT projects. They don't really do their research and they've just kind of like ask what it's about. And then we end up selling them like maybe through the interview. This one was special insofar as, they already kind of know Wizards, but already kind of collect Wizards, but, so Buffalo is, I think, who I was talking to over there. I think that he's going to interview all of us. They're even working on, I don't know what's secret and what's not, so he'll know the secret, but they're like working on kind of doing like sort of NFT mini documentaries, like different episodes. And so, yeah, we're talking to him about kind of like doing more content on Forgotten Ruins. You know, he actually put together a video, which everyone was passing around a few weeks ago, which was just sort of like an introduction to Forgotten Ruins. That was really, really good. And like, you know, I would love for that to be there to be more of that content, because I think, especially as we grow, the Ruins ecosystem can be a bit kind of intimidating or at least like confusing. And so having sort of these like easy entry points where like, all right, this is what's going on. Here's how to do it, I think is really helpful. So yeah, really, really excited for what they're doing at Hard Fork.
Yep. I remember you came out of that interview and you were like, oh, what a great interview. This guy totally gets it. And he wants to make more content with this. And I was like, wow, Dota's excited about something.
I'm super. Keep my cards close to my chest. You know, I think one of the things that I find when I like, so I think I mentioned this already, that like, I tried to get into like Aether Orcs a few weeks ago. And then I also tried to get into like Small Brains. You know, these are both projects that people have told me like, oh, you totally should look into them. Teams are super good, shipping like more than anyone else. They're really amazing. And then like, so I'm like, okay, I know this project is good. Like for sure, people who are good have told me it's good. And then when I tried to get into it, it's so complicated that like I can't make heads or tails of it. Like I know that I could just like buy the token and then figure it out, but like I don't know which token to buy, and I don't know what the rarities are, and I don't know if the token is changed and if I'm getting a good deal or like what I'm supposed to do with it. And I was just like, and then a light turned on and was like, oh, this is probably what it feels like to get into Forgotten Runes. And so I think like that's one of the things I know we're focusing on. I think both Waz and Jitsi and Matazuki have all been working on kind of this like new buyer's guide, welcome to Forgotten Runes. But I think, you know, video is just really probably one of the best, because most people would rather watch a video than read. And if you see someone explain it to you, it just feels like it comes together. So really happy with what they're doing at Hard Fork.
Yep. Sorry, Bear, what'd you say?
No, I was saying well done. That video really spoke to me. It was like, oh, like if I didn't know anything about what we were doing, it was like a really good entry point. Yep. And also there's also some really some good other press stuff that's coming up. So we're doing a push into the fall of just like, you know, getting out there and talking to the right people. And there's going to be some events. I know some people asking some questions about Halloween. But, you know, I think we're going to be doing a hard push to be talking more about the specific events and then just, you know, larger, just like publicity around the cult and Forgotten Runes. So it's exciting.
Yeah, exactly. Like we just need to be on like every podcast with any sort of like audience, or anybody who's talking about NFTs with any sort of audience. Like, you know, we have like what we have plenty to talk about, right? Most of these interviews we talk for an hour and we just feel like we're scratching the surface. So
yeah. Oh, also there's a new podcast with Andy and Deez called We Do a Little Pod. That I think will be on in the coming months too. You guys should go check it out. They're just starting up.
Cool.
Yep. Definitely making more of a push to get on podcasts and shows and just general PR stuff. Another update is comic issue number 2 is coming along. So issue 1 is currently being drawn. Riley, our amazing all-star comic book artist, has been sharing a lot of panels with us, and he's just so damn good. I can't believe we have him drawing our comic. But yeah, so issue 1 is well on its way. Issue 2, I just got a script for the other night. I dove in. A lot of new cult members, wizards, are going to be appearing in it, even if it's just a brief cameo. You know, and that, like, this whole notion of like fitting as much cult content into these larger media expressions is, you know, it's a very new thing. And these outside creatives that we bring in, like, that's one of the first like sort of obstacles or challenges we have to convey to them. Like, the source material is the Book of Lore and just general cult content. And like, at first it's kind of tricky, but like once they get it, I think they start loving it. I mean, I know that Joe, our comic writer, is loving it. He's having so much fun with content from the Book of Lore and like trying to figure out how to fit it into these stories. And I'm seeing some really fun results with that. And then I wasn't supposed to say this, but Bear might have a really impressive comic publisher lined up for us. That's all I'm going to say.
Soon to be discussed, but we have one of the top comic book publishers in the world. It looks like is gonna be signing on. So, but I don't want to say who it is because it's never done until it's done.
Exactly. Yep. Okay. And then, so questions from the Secret Tower. Emma and Juan were asking about details about the Halloween event. I don't think we can give details just yet, but damn, I'm excited about it. What do we do at Magic Machine? We always create entirely new tokenomics and events that have never been done before. I mean, again, I never want to copy what any other project is doing. I want to create something unique and original, and that's what we're doing. So, you know, I'll say this much. One way we're going to announce and explain it is, do you guys remember, like, I don't know, 6 months or more, year, 6 months ago, we used to do those like storyboard threads where it was just like a story and we would tell it through storyboards. We're going to do that with Halloween. Like the storyboards will sort of explain the event, the mechanics of the event, what it's about. So we're going to reveal it in a really fun narrative way. So that will be coming up. I don't know, maybe we'll explain details before that happens, but that's just one way you'll learn about it.
Well, and a couple other things we can share is, like, on Halloween day, there will be an event that you can come to our website and participate. And there will be a token. The tokenomics will be, everyone will have a fair chance, and you'll have a sort of fair chance in terms of however many tokens you have. So, for example, all wizards, all warriors, and all souls will qualify. Souls will have a privileged position. We haven't finalized everything. So let's just say there's always going to be some fun surprises. So I think the key thing to know is to block out your calendar for October 31st to come to our website and join the Discord. Halloween's a big day in the universe.
It's going to be fun. It's going to be really fun.
And be sure to wear your costumes. And by that, I mean your PFP, your digital costume. That's all I'll say about that. Let's see. Snoop Dogg asked, does the next comic have a big bad in it? If you're referring to issue one, I think, yeah, it does have a villain. I don't know if I would classify the villain as the big bad. That's all I'll say about that. Prometheus asked about when Forgotten Runes NES cartridge, which actually is a really question.
We would love to. It's just priorities. Like, the problem is that things cost money. And no one really has an NES. But we've talked about it all the time.
And time. To be fair, and time, I think, is a big
probably factor. Time more than money, honestly. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's an idea we've been batting around for months, and I definitely want to do it. We'll probably do it eventually. That's that. And then Shark asked, when Wizards in My Pocket? And here's what's funny about that question. I'm pretty sure Shark was referring to, like, the old Monster in My Pocket toy, but then Emma chimed in and said, are you talking about Polly Pocket? Which is, like, another pocket toy from the, like, early 90s.
Yeah, no, my daughter has, like, a lot of Polly Pockets. She loves it. So to do a wizard Polly Pocket, that is a good one.
Yeah, but we would definitely do Monster in My Pockets first.
I'll fight you for it. They need to be part of the same universe.
Dota's on Team Polly Pocket.
No, I think that we actually got a hold of the company that that made Monsters in My Pocket, and like they're interested in selling the IP, but like it was out of our it was out of making sense for us.
Yeah. But just like the NES cartridge, it's definitely something we're still interested in, as just part of the bigger franchise vision. And then finally, another just huge update. I think you all saw we posted some previews on 3D models, just a bunch of heads. This is like one of the things that I'm actually most excited about, probably like top three most exciting things in my opinion. Because it's just like the floodgates will open for so many things once we have all these 3D models. Yeah. And, you know, like first, I just want to give a shout out to Molly, who you guys have met before. She's been doing all the 2D concepts for these. And then we actually hired another person in stealth mode a few weeks ago. His name is Frog Eater. I don't know if he's in the audience now.
Frog Eater, if you're here, come up.
Yeah. Put in a request. I'll just say that I found Frog Eater during the CalArts Portfolio Day. And I saw his portfolio. It was very heavy in 3D work. But it wasn't like your average 3D portfolio.
He's here.
Okay, great. Yeah, let me give a little introduction. One thing you'll see in a lot of portfolios in animation schools is that 50% of the students, they design their portfolios to appeal to Disney or Pixar. And you look at their work and their style is just very derivative of those mainstream studios. And that's totally fine if that's your ambition. Nothing wrong with that. But Frog's portfolio, in my estimation, was not trying to get the attention of the art directors at Pixar. Frog is a wizard, and he is putting a very unique rune on the door. Frog, you emailed. I actually gave a talk to the CalArts students about NFTs and Web3, and you were the only one who reached out to me afterward and saying just how excited you were for the metaverse and NFTs. And anyway, Frog Reader, welcome to the Wizard Wednesday stage.
What's up, Frog?
Hey, what's up, wizards and witches? Glad to be here.
Welcome.
Yeah. Everybody's been loving the image we shared today of the 3D models. Frog, I really loved when you reached out to me after that talk I gave at CalArts, and you said you were interested in metaverse. Can you just sort of elaborate on what is it about metaverse or NFTs that interests you so much?
I think a big part of it is the world building. That's my imagination went wild when I first heard of the whole metaverse thing, and then also the possibilities for digital ownership also interested me a lot, because I had pivoted to more to do a lot of my artwork digitally going to school, and it's just great to be able to prove your ownership of your 3D assets or, your drawings and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And then see someone integrate them into their games and worlds and stuff in the metaverse.
Yep. Absolutely. Yeah. That was sort of what hooked me in the very beginning. Was I'd been a digital artist for a long time, but I was always upset. I can't really show digital art at a gallery. I mean, you can, but it's just kind of clunky. But now with NFTs, you can just verifiably prove that this digital artwork is yours. You can digitally sign it, and you can sell it. That's what I always loved about NFTs, at least in the very beginning. Frog. It looks like you're really having a lot of fun with the models that you're making. Do you want to say anything about that?
Oh yeah, it's so much fun working with Molly and the rest of the team developing these models. We have just so much in store, and it's just a blast to work every day. To see the kind of designs translate from the pixel art to 3D, it's really just magic,
Yes, so. Totally. Yep.
I also wanted to say, we've searched far and wide for a lot of 3D artists. And Frog just came in swinging so hard at the beginning. And so just we're so lucky to have you, man. You're so talented, and it's just it's fit like a glove. So really appreciate everything.
Yep. Yeah, and then I also just want to say one other go ahead.
Oh, one of the things that I would like to do with the 3D models that we talked about is we want to try to get some of the basic, heads and body combos out into the wild for people to start using it. Maybe that's what you're going to talk about, Elf, which is...
I was, go ahead.
Oh, yeah. So, we don't have to do all of the heads in one pass and then all of the bodies in another pass. We can kind of mix and match pairs. So, yeah, you can take it from there, Elf.
Yeah, it's going to take still yet a while to get all 10,000 characters done. But in the meantime, we want people who are interested to start making 3D cult content as soon as possible. So what I'm going to put out a call right now. If you would like a 3D rig of your wizard, or only wizards for now, let me know. DM me. The caveat is obviously you need to know how to use 3D software like Maya or Blender or whatever. But if you do, DM me and we'll try to get you a rig sooner than later. But like, please understand, ultimately, the ultimate goal is when we're done, like, everybody will get one, and you won't need to know how to use a 3D software like Blender or Maya. You'll be able to use your 3D character in any sort of game or application or meta or whatever. But before that happens, if somebody wants their character immediately, then we'll prioritize that.
Yeah, because the good news is that, you know, the we can kind of even almost go by rarity, right? Because if you take like the commonest head and the commonest body, because for these initial 3D models, for example, when you're running around in a game, the first version, you're not going to necessarily have your familiar proper rune. And so we can kind of actually get a lot of people taken care of faster by focusing on the commonest heads and bodies. And I think that's what we'll do. But yeah, if you already know how to use 3D models, let us know, because I know there's a few people who do. Let us know. We can prioritize your character so that we can get more cult content and show people how it's done. And I'm so excited for these because there's so many different things that you can do when you have 3D models, right? The 3D models can stretch and squish. They can appear in all sorts of other metas. We get more kind of rigging, you can animate them. People can use them in films. You can use them for paintings. You can use them just a million different ways to represent your characters everywhere.
Yep. Yep, definitely. Yeah, I mean, you know, maybe I'm getting ahead of myself, but we can even, like, once we're done with the first batch, we can do, like, texture swaps and geometry swaps and, like, it's just endless what you can do with 3D models.
Yeah, we can use them in video games or mini games, like, so much. Yeah, so much.
Yep. And I saw that Keshmar was asking about his cat wizard. That is the one model that we decided not to do just because cats are, the fur is too hard.
And the ears and the hat just doesn't
work. Yeah, doesn't work. So we're not doing cat wizards. No, joking. but it is interesting. Like, just like, you know, one of the things when you first start making 3D characters, the first thing you learn is like the 3D model is different from the 2D drawing. Like, just because you can draw it doesn't mean you can always model it. And so it's like, yeah, the ears are kind of tricky. Like, in the pixel art, the ears are just like sort of in front of the hat. But in the 3D model, we might have to like model them sort of going through the hat. Anyway, it's totally solvable. It's just like, it's, you know, like Frog was saying earlier, it's fun to see like the 3D translation from the 2D version.
And I'm just so impressed with all of it. Like, I feel that, like, you know, these models have so much character, but at the same time, they're like this very flexible, generic, like they can exist in a lot of environments. They're not like so stylized that you could only ever use them in one place, right? You could definitely see these characters appearing in sort of like a low poly film, like. And so, yeah, I just hats off to Elf, you and your team. I just love them so much already.
Awesome. Yeah. Yep. Cool.
Can we do a quick burn shout out? Because, Captain Owens just did a crazy burn.
Really?
Did you see this in chat?
What do you do? I didn't see it.
Take a look in the chat.
Is it a forge or a burn?
Forge.
She-Wolf. Oh, nice. Very nice. Oh, yeah, that's perfect.
It's beautiful. I love the lightning spell.
Yeah, do we have very cool.
Do we have a bot that tweets out the forges on Twitter? I actually...
Oh, wait a minute. Captain was saying that was actually Merlin. Oh, sorry, Captain.
Oh, incredible. Merlin. Good taste.
What a wizard.
Yeah. Very nice.
Oh, Owens was the burn, sorry. There's burns, there's forges, there's a lot of things happening.
Wow.
It's hard to keep track of everything in Forgotten Ruins. Yeah, and okay, we've got about 5 minutes left until our special guest comes on. So I'll just go ahead and shout out some cult content, which has been awesome this week. First of all, somebody made cookies of my goat. Did you guys see the elf cookies?
Oh yeah,
I loved it.
Someone photoshopped them onto a box. Did you see that?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, it might have been Tanya. And speaking of Tanya, she's been making some really great stuff lately. She did a process drawing today of her warrior. And then also, there's a really great cult member team up. Tad Major colored some of Tanya's comic panels.
Oh, yeah, they look amazing.
Yeah, yeah, with the nice little yellow kobold in there. Really good stuff. I'm glad you chose yellow, because everybody knows that's the color kobolds are. And then Ma Friends did this really nice piece of work. It reminds me a lot of that famous painting by Manet, a bunch of people are like having breakfast in the woods. And that's what this sort of gives me the vibes from. Another really fun account that I think we've all been enjoying is Everyday Runes. I've seen two really good pieces lately in Everyday Runes. The most recent one is hilarious. It's like this little dog in his little cute doghouse, and it's they're comparing it to the Secret Tower. Very cute. And then our friends over at Cosmic Birds of Ornithia did a really great swamp witch made out of lettuce that then was followed up by a video of a rabbit eating it, which was great. And then Why Sam, as usual, the cult content machine that he is, has this really cool new style where it's, I don't even know what to call this style. I'm looking at one right now. It's just a kobold head that's like made up of a bunch of other objects. Really cool stuff. I think Why Sam is actually going to be the recipient of one of our 3D models, by the way. Yeah, and then another fun piece I saw was from Cosmic Mage Ariadne of the Forest, who is... I've been seeing a lot of versions of her warrior, Joan Danger. I said it last week, but this warrior is so much fun because it's one of those warriors that has a shield but no weapon. And just this warrior is like really making it work. It's just a fascinating idea of a warrior that has a shield and no weapon. Another fun meme / cult content in the making is from our infamous Magus Wazir. Wazir's got two new things going on. Number one is the Runiverse restaurant, McWazir's.
Oh, yeah.
So that's good.
Great. I need one of those visors.
I know. It's really good stuff. And then also, he's developing a new sport in the Runeverse called Runeball. Does anybody know anything about Runeball and what are the rules of Runeball? And is it more fun than Quidditch?
Definitely more fun than Quidditch.
Yeah, I think the answer is definitely.
Someone posted some, I don't know if it was Midjourney or another AI, but the Runeball AI art was incredible. There were like three images and it just like got my mind running a million miles an hour.
Yep, I did see it. Really good stuff. I can't wait to see what happens with Runeball. And then two more pieces before we introduce our special guest. Emma made this just adorable Legend of Zelda derivative where it says it's dangerous to go alone, take this, and then it's us three giving Emma a heart.
Yeah.
I love it. Here's what I love about it. You know, Gandalf, his thing is like, I find power in the small and everyday things, and love and joy are often more powerful than like might and violence. And you know, there's deep wisdom in that. So This little piece that Emma made is just great. I love it, and it says more than what meets the eye, I think. And then finally, Magasixar of the Hills commissioned Daniela Ilustra for this really great piece of his wizard and the Death Shroom and the Sacred Flame. There's just so much story going on in this particular illustration. Always good stuff from Daniela. Okay, our special guest is here, and I'm going to invite him up now.
I've shared all of the tweets that we mentioned for with cult content images in the spaces above. So, I think if you're listening in, an important part of this process of going through the cult content is, of course, seeing the images visually, right? Otherwise, it's just words. So, yeah, we'll have those there. And, Kel usually does a pretty good job at aggregating the cult content in his Twitter threads and storing them in Tree, the wiki software that's being developed by our very own Merlin. So typically if you're listening to this and you're like, driving or whatever, you can usually find this episode of Wizard Wednesday on the Forgotten Runes wiki, where Kel will link to the cult content on Tree. I know it's roundabout, but the cult content is such a joy. And so, yeah, be sure to check it out.
And without further ado, let me welcome Dan Sickles to Wizard Wednesday. Dan is a documentary film director, writer, actor, and producer. And we are bringing him on today to talk about his upcoming film, New Here, which is a film about NFTs. And he was kind enough to include yours truly in the film. So, Dan, welcome to Wizard Wednesday.
Hello. How are you, man? It's been a minute. I'm super happy to be here.
Yeah, no, it has been a minute, Dan. I'm really happy you're here. I've got a bunch of questions for you.
Before we get into the questions, though, I do actually want to congratulate you guys. As a storyteller in the space, I have been like watching everything that you've been building in the time that we spoke in LA. And it's incredible to see. Like, I love that you guys have teamed up with Titmouse. Like, their work is unbelievable. The teaser that you guys put out for the series is, it looks so sick. And like, I think that you're continuing the great work that we spoke about during that interview of just like creating a space where people can like, come and lend their lore and build out this story together. Very, very happy to reconnect with you about this film, but also everything that you guys are doing. It's really unbelievable.
Thanks, Dan. Really appreciate it. Thank you for taking the time to come on. And I was there behind the camera hanging out while you were interviewing Elf.
Yes.
Like, would love to like have you tell the cult a little bit about what you're doing, because the film is just, we're so excited about it and we're honored to have Elf be a part of it.
Yeah, for sure. So I fell into this space about like a year and a half ago. I'm a relative noob, I'd say, to a lot of the people that I've been speaking to in the course of making this film. But I immediately fell in love with the crypto art NFT space, and dove into some communities like right off the bat and got to learning right away. And very quickly, I kind of figured if I'm going to spend a lot of my time and, quite a bit of my money playing around in this arena, I may as well do like the thing that I know how to do best, or at least I think I know how to do best, and that's make films. A lot of my work has to do with demystifying otherwise kind of scary or foreign concepts, while, kind of rooting these concepts in the communities that are, building them. And that's really what I've been working on for about the past 16 months or so. I put together a team, actually a crypto native team. All of my producers are in the space. They're all collectors. They've all been building in various ways. And, over the past 16 months, I've conducted about 90 different interviews with different artists and devs and thinkers and collectors from really all over the world. To tell the oral history of how this space was built and really where it's headed.
So it's like a super, super ambitious project. You know, we're still very much in the thick of it. But it's been, like, honestly, like, the most enlightening journey of my creative life so far. I mean, like, it's sort of whatever. I don't necessarily, I'm preaching to the choir here, but I do believe that the most brilliant minds of today are really working in the crypto arena. So, you know, to be hanging out with people like Elf, but then also to film with, you know, like, Tyler Hobbs and Fuckrender and Art Gnome and I mean, Baron Davis, you know, and Pussy Riot. It's just like, it's like the most vibrant, crazy community. And we're all here doing really cool work. And that's basically what I've been doing for the past year or so.
Yeah, Dan, I was like, when I showed up that day, I knew nothing about the film you were making and anything about your team. And I remember sitting down and immediately you started asking really good questions. You know, oftentimes you'll get in an interview and the interviewer will have no clue who you are, what you're about. And you're like, just sort of explaining things from very fundamental, basic levels. But you, like, obviously know what crypto and NFTs are. And not only that, but, like, you understand just art in general. And I was really impressed by the questions that you were asking, because I just felt like I could give really interesting answers to these really good questions.
Well, thank you, man. I appreciate that. That's a high honor for a nonfiction filmmaker. But I love this space. Like, I authentically love this space, and I authentically love the people who are building in it. And I think that there's right now a bit of an issue with really a lack of dignity. You know, I don't think, yep. like very often we see a lot of these interviews and how they're filmed, and, you know, people are doing it on their iPhone or whatever, and they don't look great. And, you know, I think that where my work lies right now is trying to reverse that. You know, it's one thing to talk about people making $69 million on this one auction, right? It's another thing to actually talk about how Mike showed up every single motherfucking day at his desk and was making art. And even before that, was making, like, free video clips for music videos for artists before he was monetizing any of that work, you know, even before NFTs. So, like sort of resetting, like, how we understand some of the context is kind of vital at this moment. You know, I think, like, Forgotten Runes, it's a good example. Like, there's a way of looking at this project is like, okay, cool, these are pixelated, you know, wizards. It's another thing to actually, like, peek underneath the hood and, like, look at all of the incredible work that your community is doing and building up a story as to what these pixelated images actually mean, right?
Right, yeah, yeah.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's easy, and I think it's going to come, like, I don't know, maybe you can tell us about, like, what the release looks like or if you know when it comes out, but my hunch is that this will come out at a time when crypto hopefully is making some strides into more mainstream. And I think you telling the story behind the artists who are helping, like, you know, push crypto into more culture, I think it could be a really important piece for the space and to give context about what's going on.
Yeah, I mean, that's my hope too, right? I mean, like, we're very much in a bear market, which unfortunately makes my job a lot easier.
Yeah,
it was tricky, like, getting access to some sort of, like, the bigger names in the space last year, over the past year and a half, right? Because everyone was really busy and everyone was trying to make media more or less. And, you know, now that we're still here, it's definitely easier to get people's ear. But, you know, again, like, I'm very thorough with how I make films. We've done 90 interviews. I think that at least, like, there's probably at least 15 more to go to really round out this, like, oral history. And it sounds, like, utterly absurd, I think, to somebody who might be outside of this process. But, like, to me, it's of the utmost importance that the story of this space is also decentralized in that way. I mean, like you guys are talking about with your lore, that it isn't, like, one story of crypto art that's being told. This is how it happened, A, B, C, D. But that, like, we understand that, like, this is a global movement happening in parallel, and there's people doing work that speaks to one another all at the same time. But that the superlative of first isn't necessarily as relevant as who's been showing up consistently, you know, yes, for years.
Totally agree.
What's, Dan, what is, if there was like, there's like one purpose for the film, what are you trying to communicate by making this film and doing all these interviews?
I mean, there's a few different ways I could answer that, right? I guess like ultimately, the film is really like looking at humans have this habit of building really beautiful systems in order to build and interact and fuck with each other. And that beyond all the tech of crypto and having a wallet and what chain you're on, that's really what this system is built to enable us to do better. And that's it, you know, that like we have these different chains and we have all of that. And like there's proof of stake and proof of work and blah, 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 blah. And like, that's what makes it scary for a lot of people. But ultimately, what this is all being built to do is exactly what we're doing now, you know, manifesting these communities in these virtual spaces and like sharing a bit about ourselves, sharing what we do, sharing what we like, sharing what we don't like, being human, right? That's really what the film is rooted in. Because if you go back to the initial beginnings of this space, I mean, like there was a real purity in terms of what people were after when this was being built. And it was this idea of authenticating virtual objects, not necessarily like monetizing them to the heavens, but like really just authenticating them, making sure that like this sort of hash said, like, this is where this lives, this is who owns it, and this is who it was created by. And moving from there, but you like look at like early on in these communities, like Rare Pepes and CryptoPunks, and they were all sharing. I mean, much like you guys are now, before they were talking about any sort of floor price or like, you know, like the monetary underpinnings of it.
Yes. Yeah. I love that mission, and that's why you're making the film, because I still truly believe in I'm going to say revolutionary ambitions behind just the whole NFT movement, because it is coming from a very pure place that I think humanity can really benefit from. But what's amazing is like, we have certainly experienced this, and I'm curious if you have experienced any kind of backlash. Like, so many people, if you just say the word NFT, they immediately just have a knee-jerk reaction to that's evil and you're Satan for even talking about that. Have you experienced any of that?
Personally, like, I honestly can't say that I have. And I think that's because, you know, my first film, I started making that film in 2010, and that was about the trans liberation movement happening in Puerto Rico. And in 2010, when I started making that film, there wasn't much trans media, you know, about the trans liberation movement happening anywhere in the world. So I think that might be a sort of an effect of me kind of being the person in my group of friends who's constantly showing up being like, hey, like, look at this thing that no one's talking about. And everyone yep. kind of rolling their eyes at me, but then maybe doing a bit of digging once they leave the room, you know? And I think that that's kind of just the dynamic that I have within my friend group. Yep. But I have heard the general pushback, and I do hear a lot of fear, and man, I get it. Like, I totally get it. It's like, we are showing up in a very chaotic moment in culture in general, saying like, hey guys, actually here is the shiny thing that you should be paying attention to. Yeah. And like, there's so many shiny things that are all sort of demanding that same attention from the same people who have the same amount of bandwidth, right? And yep. you know, everyone is so strapped for cash. No one knows what money is. No one knows what the value is. Like, no one knows how many dollars exist. Like, everything's a mess. And when you then look at this other financialized system, I think it's really, really hard to crack through that barrier of like, this is a scam. No, this has to be a scam, because like the traditional yeah. paradigm is definitely a scam. So yeah. if that one was invented by people and like they're still alive, then that's doubly scammy, right? Like,
yeah.
I see it. But I think that, yeah, again, like our work has to do with also then understanding the traditional paradigm and being like, hey guys, like the traditional finance system is also, it's really fucked. And if anything, like if you look over here, this might be your next best shot
at staying afloat during the coming crisis, or God forbid, even moving up in the world, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
But
that
takes so much retelling. I think that story, right?
It really does. And like, I agree. Like I can see why people have this knee jerk hatred towards it. I mean, for one, yeah, there's a lot of conflict and distrust in the establishment right now. And as an answer to that, there's a lot of like false prophets and false messiahs offering solutions that are not solutions at all. And so they see NFTs come along and they already have a bad taste in their mouth from other crypto scams. And so, I can see why there's a mistrust.
Scams in general, right?
Yeah.
I mean, like everyone's 401k was like wiped out after 2008, right? Like it's like that was supposed to be not a scam. Like higher education was supposed to be not a scam. The healthcare system in the States was supposed to be not a scam. So Bitcoin, like fuck you, dude. Like, you know what I mean?
But it's up to projects like Forgotten Ruins and films like yours to just do the job of evangelizing. You know, I remember I told Dota once a long time ago, like, I don't remember the context. He was frustrated with some outside partner not understanding. And I was like, dude, like, part of our job is to evangelize, whether we like it or not. It's what we have to do.
Yeah. And to continue to be real, like you're saying about like the false prophets, the bullshit superlatives, like the vapid promises, like those exist here too. And you know, we can't ignore them either as we're evangelizing.
Yeah, totally. But so Dan, do you have any indication where people can see this film when it's done?
Not yet. No. So, I mean, so how this is working is like this film is staying independent until another announcement comes that we've sort of sold this to somebody. But our priority as a team right now is to essentially keep all of this incredible footage, all this great data that we have from our community and to keep the project independent so it can be realized by the team of artists that's building it and not outside parties, right?
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about isn't there a mint happening this week?
Yeah, exactly. So we're fundraising for part of the budget. The film has actually received quite a few grants from the community that we're going to be making announcements about soon. But we are realizing part of the film budget through an NFT drop. The allow list is actually opening up on Monday, and I believe you guys actually have a specific pre-mint sign up. That you can make available through the Discord and we can hook you up with. But the
just real quick on that. I will post this pre-mint sign up in the Alpha channel in our Discord. Just look forward to that. Go ahead, Dan.
Yeah, so you know, like it opens on Monday, public mint opens on Wednesday, and essentially what we've done is we've taken all of the iconic traits of our cast and we are generating a 10,000 avatar collection using all of those traits. So Elf, you've seen yours, right? I mean, yours actually is one of the sickest in the entire collection.
It looks so good.
It is so good.
Yeah, it's very cool. But you know, so what might happen when you buy one of the new year avatars is like you might get Elf's head with like Richard's 3D glasses and Tyler Hobbs's body, right?
Fun.
Yeah, so you know, it's a really cool way of celebrating the entire cast while raising the budget of the film. Some important things to note about our mint that I think makes it special is that 15% of the gross revenue for this project in perpetuity is going to be going to the artist wallets. So all of the artists who are included, including Elf, will be receiving essentially residuals from this NFT drop.
Amazing.
By virtue of being a part of the film and lending us your time. And those tokens are going to unlock a whole series of other programming that we have running parallel to the actual production of the film. It's kind of wild because like I'm very used to like making a film and kind of doing it in quiet, like with my team. Web3 has really more or less fucked that process in really interesting ways. And you know, we're making this film in public and there's a lot of really cool stuff that we have coming out the pipeline involving the materials that we've captured and our cast. So, you know, these tokens will live beyond just funding the film or just a ticket for the film itself, which we have a lot more to talk about once the mint starts next week.
I'm not sure if there's time. Maybe we can have you on again when like there's another sort of window of promotion, but I'd love to hear sort of how Web3 has deviated from like your traditional sort of path of making a film. Because of all, you know, the stuff with the television show and, yeah, you know, there's just a lot, there's like, it's a beautiful thing, but it's also like traditional distributors don't really understand it. And when it doesn't fit in a box, it's like getting a loan for a house, right? Like you can
exactly
have all the cash in the bank, but they're like, well, you don't make this much money on a monthly basis. Anyway, we should definitely have you on when it's time for the release, however that takes shape.
Yeah, no, absolutely. It would be really fun to talk about with you guys because we are in a very similar boat that way. I guess like the sort of biggest theme that I will speak to for that is just that, you know, you guys work in the internet and I work in the internet now, and working in the internet, it's this weird phenomenon where like the more you give it, like the more it demands from you, you know? And like there are moments where like my crew and I, like where we're just like, kind of sitting around and we're like, shit, like we wanted to make a movie, you know? And like, we're making a movie and now we have this NFT drop and now we're organizing this archive. And now we're doing like these 10 other things, which we're super, super amped about, but it's it's an iceberg, not the tip.
Yes, Dota spoke about this in an interview just the other day. But yeah, an NFT project is no joke. It's like I love every minute of it, but it can be demanding,
for sure. And I mean, like it's also a function of you guys being on the forefront of figuring out what it means to lead an NFT project too, right? So like there's probably so much energy that goes into failing stuff or stuff that doesn't even work, so that like the next group behind you guys can like look at that and be like, yeah, okay, that thing didn't work for Forgotten Runes. That's how we can avoid that potential pitfall, right?
Right.
Yeah. Yep. You're welcome, future project.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
But yeah, it's like it's a wild process. But honestly, I mean, like, you know, it's cheesy to say, but like there are moments where like I actually return to like some of the interviews that I've done and like some of the artists that I've met, and like that really helps me re-remember like why we're working so hard to make this NFT drop, why we're talking about marketing materials for hours during the day, like why we're figuring out like the mint logistics and all of that, like what all of this is for, you know. And to that end, actually, Elf, I did pull a quote that we listen to pretty often from our interview that I can actually play. I think I have it teed up if you want to hear it.
Oh, interesting.
A little soundbite.
Yes. This is a New Here exclusive.
All right.
Yeah, let me know if this is loud enough, because I am on headphones, so I'm just going to put it on very loud. Here we go.
We have a phrase called putting your rune on the door. And that means to put your mark on the world. That means to tell the world who you are and to speak your own truth, because you are a goddamn wizard. You have magic inside of you.
Yeah. Ding. Hell yeah!
Did you guys hear that? Wizard.
But I love those moments, man. And it's like we have like crew, it's like we have a rip reel of these moments where it's just like, you know, where we're feeling like bogged down or like we're hitting like in the mud, whatever. And then like we just like hit it and it's just like there's Elf being like, you're a fucking wizard. Go for it, motherfucker.
Yes.
Oh, that, I'm so glad you played that. That's great.
Yeah, that's great.
Man. No,
and Dan. And Dan, I know, like, I think we had met some of the executive producers on the film, but it goes without saying, but I'll say it anyway. Anything we can do to help, promote it, connect you to anyone, always feel free to reach out. And then, you know, I don't know, are you going to go do the typical sort of film festival route and like look for a distributor like that, or?
Yeah, so that's what I'm used to. I mean, like, it's like my previous films have premiered at festivals. My last one premiered at Sundance, and actually I won Sundance in 2017 with that film.
No big deal, just winning Sundance, no big deal.
And yeah, I mean, like, that for me is like such a fun way to go, because it's like, you know, you're still not supposed to be like this refined kind of movie yet. You can still be like a raw crew rolling up to a film festival. It's very Entourage, you know. And I don't know, that's how I like to do it. But, you know, we have great material and we have an incredible cast. And I also wouldn't be surprised if, like, along the way, as we're finishing this film up, the streamers start to hit us up. They know me. I've worked with them before. They know my producers. One of them, Shane Boris, is actually, he's an Academy Award nominated producer, and his films are, he has two out right now that are doing quite well. So I wouldn't be surprised if we start to be approached more aggressively as we wind down this film. But that, I think that those are decisions that we're gonna make as a community. You know, once we have this drop, see who shows up. I think that those are conversations that we really wanna bring to the group of supporters and sort of see how we navigate this together.
Very cool. Very cool. Yeah. Well, we're excited. We're excited. This is, you know, we're all trying to push this thing forward. And, you know, we actually get a lot of flack, surprisingly, from people about, like, us. Maybe it feels like this is such, like, a Web 2 thing to do, to, like, get on a streamer, whether it's your doc or it's our television show. And we feel like the space is still just so...
We need it.
Fancy. We need it. And, like, yeah. You know, we talk about it all the time, like, you know, having, you know, whether it's the story you're telling or we're telling, or all of the other projects that are, like, running after, you know, more traditional formats, like, those are the biggest billboards in the world that will allow people to understand what's actually happening.
Yeah, we're defining what Web3 is. When we get a show on Netflix, then in a year from now, that will be Web3. Like, exactly. Having a show
will include one of the things that it includes.
Yeah, and it's of this moment. I mean, like, I think that, like, it's important for us because it's something that we're able to do, right, is actually take the temperature of culture and be like, this is how this fits in right now. This is the season for this. Because it doesn't work if we're just going to sort of, like, produce all this great media and feed it into the same echo chamber that already exists, right?
Preach. Yep.
Well, Dan, listen, it's been awesome having you on. We've got about 3 minutes left. Let me ask a question out of nowhere, kind of. I don't know if you've seen Rings of Power or House of Dragons, but if you have, which one do you like better?
I'll say Rings of Power, just because.
All right!
But one of my best friends is starring in it, actually.
Okay.
He plays Aaron Deere. That's how I say his name, yeah?
Sure. Yeah, I think that's right.
Ismail. Yeah. I mean, so it's a bit, I'm a bit biased that way. I just know how hard he's been working for years. And, like, this is a huge break for him. And I know one of the producers quite well. And it's like, it's an incredible feat, that show.
Nice. Nice. Yeah, no, it's, yeah, I mean,
am I in the majority or the minority here?
I think you're in the minority, but that's okay.
I'll take it.
No, it's I think there's a lot to like about Rings of Power, you know, but anyway, we'll talk about that next week.
Sure.
Dan, again, thank you so much for coming on. You're always invited to come back whenever there's any new announcements about the film. If you guys missed it, the film is called New Here. It's a documentary about NFTs, I filmed for it. I don't know how many scenes I'll have in it, but hopefully at least one.
It's gonna be the whole film is actually. It's really hell. Yeah, check out newhere.xyz. That's where a lot of the information for the film lives, as well as the mint information.
Yep, and we'll put some information about the mint in our Discord. One of your team members told me, I think Wizards, there's like 100 spots for Wizards. So anyway, thank you so much, Dan.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Dan.
I wanted to give Bill Gaines a chance to mention something that he's been working on before we wrap up.
Oh, okay. Bill, what up, guy?
Hello.
Hello.
Interesting conversation. So we have been working on a website. I guess it's more, we've been working on a website called cultcontent.whatthefuck or WTF. basically it's going to be a platform with links to all of the various cult content that has been created. It can be a little overwhelming or just like hard to figure out what all is going on in the cult. Yep. So like we have a link to like the Runes game on there, the Forgotten Marketplace, the babies, the Cucumber Dogs, the spell book, and some other things as well. We've got the Withstock Wardrobe app that we had made set up on there, and it can also we can also set it up to dress warriors and souls now. So
awesome.
Basically, if you have assets that are made for any of the Runeverse characters, we can set it up on there so people can dress up their characters. And if you want to, like, if you want to sell any of these, or if you want to, like, set up a custom mint for yourself, like, we have everything built out to make it really easy for creators to just come and set everything that they need up, and they're good to go. Basically, they don't need to do any programming, they don't need to do anything other than make art. And then we do have future plans to make the Book of War that's on there from the Anthenium. So we have like the Chaotic Companion and the Baby's Book of Lore, and there's also the ability to write lore for cucumbers or Cucumber Dogs as well.
Okay.
And we do have the baby transformations. They were supposed to be launching right after this, but I've been having a little bit of an issue getting the website live. But there will be signups to participate in the first babies event, probably later tonight or tomorrow, and then going through on Monday, and then we'll start the adventure to the farm.
Oh my god, the baby wizards are going to the farm.
Yes, it's been a long time coming. We've been filling our free time up with shenanigans. But yeah, so if anyone wants to make any projects, we can help you out. We have the website, we have the apps made. And we will be doing the Forgotten Punks by Astro Young. We'll be doing the mint on there later this week once everything is all wrapped up.
This sounds like great fun.
This is awesome. Thank you so much, Al.
Yeah, Bill, I love it. I love the things that you and Acid do. I love the baby wizards. I love the psychedelic wizards. It's just like a really great wrinkle of the Runeverse, all the things that you guys are doing. So thanks, man.
Appreciate it. And one more thing, I kind of wanted to put out a call to action. If anyone wants to collaborate on a Halloween costume asset pack to give out to the cult, if you want to make various costumes for wizards or warriors, I think a community made asset pack would be pretty cool.
Yep. Love it. All right, anything else?
That's it for me.
That's all you got, right?
Yeah.
Thank you, Bill. That is really exciting. Super fun. Thanks for organizing that. So we'll drop the link in Discord so everyone can take a look. All right. I think we're at time. Yeah? Oh, go ahead.
It's time. Yeah, this has been Elf, Dota, Bear Snake, Dan Sickles, Bill Gaines, Frog Eater, and the rest of the Forgotten Runes Wizards cult channeling out from the Quantum Downs.
Bye.
Be in, you goddamned wizards. Yeah.